Boom. 3, 2, 1. Good afternoon, Trav Roebuck.
But it might be nighttime outside. It might be morning, considering.
I'm surprised it's not nighttime now. It's taken me so long to get this computer working.
I didn't want to say it, but there we go. I just always find it weird how everybody says good afternoon or good morning or like, hi guys, here we are. Yes. Like, it's just, okay, cool. Like,
I should do something to confuse people. Like, you know.
Thanks for watching.
Thanks for watching. It's 2 a.m.
Actually, a funny story about that quickly, and I know that we've already gone off topic, which is classic me, but do you remember Astro Boy, the cartoon?
Yes.
I don't know if you remember, but the credits were always at the start. The end credits were at the start of the show, and I used to love Astro Boy so much, and my sister hated it, and she used to always put it on and go, oh, look, it's just finished, and I would be devastated and so upset. And then one day she wasn't there, she was at a friend's, and I watched it and I was like, oh, I've just missed it again. Like, why can I never watch this show? And then it came on and it was weird. It was just this crazy thing where it was back, like back to front.
What channel was Astro Boy on?
Channel 2.
It was Channel 2. Mm. All the good stuff was on Channel 2.
Amazing.
When I was a kid. Yeah. So I always say to people, do you remember Sigmund the Sea Monster?
No.
And everybody, exactly. No one remembers it. But it was around, it was kind of near, it was before the goodies, somewhere around there.
Hang on a second. Has anybody ever said yes? Is this not a figment of your imagination? Did you make this character up?
No, I would ask everybody. Yeah. And then Lily, my partner, my wife, would say to me, you're just making that up. There was never a show called Sigmund the Sea Monster. And I said, trust me, there is. So sure enough, YouTube comes out.
Yeah, great.
The first thing I looked up, Sigmund the Sea Monster. Yeah, it's definitely a show.
But, because otherwise you'd go, well, thank you, Lily. I'm going to actually make $1 million because all these ideas that I have are amazing.
I need to. Well, that's my next show
on
Facebook Live is, I need a sea monster. Someone called Sigmund. Okay. I don't know. It's probably not going to work.
Sea monster or SEA?
I'm not
or
sure.
Sea monster?
I need to think. I need to whiteboard it.
Yeah.
That's I need to term. Whiteboard it with someone like you.
Nah.
Like, now, if you just tuned in and you're wondering,
who the hell is this
Roebuck,
guy?
I've heard this guy's voice before. Well, you know what? Yep. Say something, Trav, that they may know you for.
I'm like Wilson from Home Improvement. Remember that?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, well, you never see you.
Yeah.
Maybe 101 on the Fox. We are Melbourne's number one for hits and old school. Sitting here with the guitar colonel, going to play some hits.
Man, there you go.
Golden tonsils.
A radio staple. A radio legend.
Oh, well,
I don't chuck it out too lightly, but I'm going to chuck it out. Boomed it.
A radio legend said no to this show, but we got Trav instead.
I tried a few radio legends and it was all no, but we got Trav. Also, producer.
Yeah.
Or on the Hamish and Andy show.
Yeah, Hamish and Andy, Dan and Maz, you might have known on we did breakfast with them for a bit as well, which was fun.
Yeah.
The good thing about breakfast, especially weekends, is you can do what you want and nobody listens, which is pretty much like and when I say nobody listens, I mean like the bosses.
Yeah.
Just like Hamish and Andy, I suppose.
They're having a normal breakfast somewhere.
Yeah, it's the weekend, so they're probably at the pub drinking or something, you know.
Or whatever they're
doing boss things.
Gudinski style stuff.
Yeah. Okay. Nice weather we're having today. Yeah. So yeah, no. And Hamish and Andy, I've done a show with Jules London, Emma Friedman that I looked after. I did a YouTube show, which I hated, and I'm not afraid to say it. But Hamish and Andy's probably the big one.
What was the YouTube show you did not like?
It was the YouTube show with Marty Smiley and Michael Beveridge.
Okay. What did you not like about it?
It just wasn't very organized from other members of the team.
Unlike this show.
Yes.
Trav's my new Hamish and Andy. Okay. Yeah. Pretty big.
Yeah.
Kind of good. But now he's come to help me out. Mm. And I need the help. So I've called in the big guns. Now
they should be coming soon.
Trav, the first gun is here.
Yeah.
Now, Trav, you're from WA.
I am from Perth. Originally. And if you have a look, I think I made this joke to you before, but right there is where I cut my other head off, the scar. I chose
this. You
still
see a little bit of it.
I know, I chose this one. I'm not too sure whether I made the right choice, but yeah, I'm from Perth originally. So over there, 25 years.
Right.
And diesel mechanic by trade.
Really?
Yeah, diesel mechanic.
That's amazing.
Parents told me that I needed to go to uni or get a trade.
Yeah.
Did.
Sensible advice.
Not
good on your mum and dad.
They don't know what they're talking about. Had no idea how to go to uni, exactly. Yeah. So I was like, all right, give me something I can do. Yeah. Diesel mechanic. Hated it, finished it.
Yeah.
Went back to school. Actually did a music production course.
Right.
At Leadable TAFE, which I don't want to skip too far ahead in the story. But then, yeah, like literally was doing that. Music performance and production.
Yeah.
My lecturer always said that I would be an amazing performer if I could sing or play an instrument properly, but yes. I just had like the show off, and
hence the guitar.
This is a prop guitar. It's like one of those ones at Vegas when you get like the straw hanging out of it, you just walk around, you're like,
it's filled with whiskey.
With, well, Jesus,
yeah, we've awesome. Been on the show recently, we've been talking about ways of smuggling whiskey into AC/DC concerts.
Can I tell you the greatest story?
Please.
This is legitimately not rehearsed, and it was one of my most favourite things in the world. So when I first moved to Melbourne in 2013, so I went to a Blink-182 concert at the Sydney Meyer Bowl, which I love Blink-182.
Yes.
Such a huge fan.
Yes.
And I'm sitting there, and it was that kind of, I suppose, really, that stage when it was a bit sad, you know, like they hadn't had a hit for ages and they were doing a tour, and I was like, nostalgia, all right, I'll go.
Ready start performing on a boat.
100%, yeah. Boats and hoes. And I went there, and I just remember seeing this guy, and he ripped off his prosthetic leg.
Right.
And then he's got it in the air and he's pumping it like he just don't care, right? And then he pulls it down and he grabs out a bottle of Jack Daniels out of the leg and starts sculling it and then pumping said limb in the air again. Who's going to tell you, I want to check your prosthetic leg for alcohol walking into a concert?
It turned their career around.
100%. So you know what? I actually feel like if you want, maybe you should chop your lower leg off and then you've got yourself a little smuggle for life.
One saw,
one
bottle of Jack Daniels,
and
boom, away you go.
But maybe drink the Jack Daniels first, because, you know, to numb the pain.
Yeah. Well, we had an AC/DC special a couple of weeks ago and some guy wrote in and he said, my buddy, he smuggled a bottle of whiskey into an AC/DC concert in a barbecued chicken.
Right.
And so then we were like, well, hang on, how big was the bottle and how big was the chicken?
Was it a turkey?
Well, that's...
one of those mini bar, like Jack Daniels. Or, yeah, wow.
Could be, 10 of those or, I don't know, interesting. Yeah. So how did you get into radio?
Okay, so I did the music course. Yes. And because of that, I just went through a bit of a life change and was like, okay, I don't really know what I want to do. I want to do something in music, maybe touring, like manager or something like that.
Yes.
And so I just, a friend's girlfriend was attractive and she was doing, she was doing promotions. So she was a promotion model in the nightclubs. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I said to her, I was a single guy, and I said, look, can you hook me up with your single girlfriends? Like, the promotional models are hot. Like, I'd love to do that. She goes, well, why don't you come and work? There's not many guys that do it. And literally, you know, come and be a promo guy. We need guys. We, you know, you're a good talker. Why not? And I was like, ah, okay, cool. Yeah. Good side job.
Yeah.
So I did that. And we had a promo for Corona, not sponsored. But feel free to sponsor us if you wish. Corona.
Soon to be.
Yeah.
Hola.
I can't remember their tagline.
I think it's just hola.
Okay, hola. That's very racist. Mexican. You know, it's fine. Hey, why not both, hey? Anyway, old El Paso shout out. And so, so we did a Corona promo at a pub that had 92.9, the local Fox FM or Today FM, wherever you're, if you're in Sydney or wherever you're watching, the local station that Hamish and Andy is on, and they did a broadcast from the pub. And so for between, I think, 3 to 8, we'd walk around with Corona specials, and we did a 4-week run. And I met a guy who was on air there, and I met the guys that drive the cars and things, and got to be pretty good friends with them because, you know, we worked together, and they just said, hey, why don't you come down? So I started driving the cars from that, and just loved it, and got put into a studio, and, you know, knew how to edit and knew how to use some software, and they were like, oh, okay, well, can you help out? And yeah.
How long ago was that?
2006.
Right.
Yeah, 12 years ago. Yeah.
It's not too long ago, though. It's quite a fast sort of track through.
Oh, yeah, I suppose it is. But, like, I mean, what? Like, just do it, you know? Like, yeah. I mean, you can spend a whole, I think Zuckerberg said it best, you know, get in there and do it, even if it's not perfect. And it definitely was not perfect. But, yeah.
It's similar to the, is it Carl Sandilands?
No, please never mention his name.
KS. We'll just go KS. I think KS started driving.
But now I know that's too obvious. Let's say K Sandilands.
K Sandilands.
He did. And actually in Perth as well. He was in sales in Perth. I wasn't there at the time.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Mm. So you said you made a few mess-ups. Give me one of the grand mess-ups.
I was going to say, how long have you got?
Well, go with the best one.
Okay, well, one of them in particular, I'll just tease a couple of quick ones that, you know, we can tell at a later time. But yes. I remember once needing to play a song and grabbing a song and really quickly to fill some time. Yeah. And I threw in a song, What's My Age Again, one of my favorite Blink-182 songs. Yeah. It was live and it was exactly the time that I needed to fill.
Yeah.
And that's a very short song, so I was like, I'm going to chuck that in there. Let's just say it was a live version that was unedited and had many racial slurs and swear words. That was fun. But my grand of all, I literally flew into Sydney 2 weeks beforehand. And in Sydney, they have this amazing New Year's Eve fireworks on the harbour. They simulcast that on Channel 10. They have that on Today FM. There's a contract. So, you know, every 2 or 3 years, all the radio stations can bid for it. Yeah. At that point, Today FM was about to go into their last year of that contract. They said, Trav, look, you know, we're happy with your skills. You're actually quite good in the studio. So I was pushing buttons and there was a couple of broadcasters down there live from the fireworks. And at 9 o'clock, I needed to pull up one line, which was from the Channel 10 control tower and had the meticulously planned out soundtrack that would have cues and fire off fireworks and boom in the right places and all of that kind of stuff. And that one worked fine at 9 o'clock. That was great. And I had a backup CD in a CDJ that I could put up there, and I was meant to, as soon as that happened, I was like, it struck 9 o'clock, I was meant to hit bang on the player on the CDJ, bang on the line, and just in case the line didn't work. I got a little bit ahead of myself and thought, I've got this. The midnight one, countdown, perfectly, timed it perfectly, pulled the fader up, had it on, silence. 12 o'clock, fireworks going off. 12 o'clock and 5 seconds, silence. What is happening? 12 o'clock, 10 seconds, silence. I'm scrambling around like you would not believe. Like, I haven't put the CD in the backup CD player and I haven't hit that off. I can't even find it. It was different to the 9 o'clock one and I panicked. And so I grabbed the first song. I just typed in A and up came the first song. So I just threw out this song, Daft Punk Around the World.
Great tune. Yes.
Nowhere near what Channel 10 were expecting. This was going live on Channel 10, live around basically all of the city radios. Phone lines going off, like ringing the bosses. What is happening? There's a thing called a withheld emergency line. That's when you stuff up. Like, there is a boss that calls that line, and one is bad. Like, I have nightmares to this day about that. Hearing that sound going off, because it's a different sound and you know straight away you've done something.
Were you there on your own?
On my own. I had 8 of them going off. And I'm going, what is going on here?
It's the whole panel.
That song runs out. I bring Sex on Fire by Kings Leon.
It's a nice chaser.
At this point, it's 12:08 and like 30 seconds. Half the fireworks have gone off. To absolutely the wrong soundtrack. I found the CD, thrown it into the CD player. In my head, I've gone, okay, I've got to skip forward 8 minutes because it's 12:08 and it started at 12 o'clock. So I'm skipping, hit it, it's way out of sync. I'm live trying to like catch up and jog it in there. And I'm like, oh my gosh, like it is all out of control. I literally finished that shift. I felt like jumping into a cab, going to the Sydney airport and going, that's it, I'm out. Mate, I'm done, I'm fired.
But you kept going. You did it.
I don't know how.
That's a lesson to young people playing.
Yeah.
If you make a stuff up on stage, just keep going.
Just keep going.
Just keep going. Yeah, and if eight emergency phone lines ring, that's okay. It wasn't 10. 10 would be bad.
No, because there's only eight lines. Literally. There would have been 40,000 if there was 40,000 lines.
Well, you kept on going. Hey. We've got some people on.
Oh, okay.
Which is interesting at this time of the day. G'day from LAX.
Oh, hello. It's my mum.
Neil. There we go.
Is it Neil?
It's Neil Boland.
Neil Young.
Neil Young is probably there as well.
He is probably. Who else we got?
We have Andrew Bagley. G'day, Andrew.
Are you
Michael Ray's on?
Andrew Bagley, are you related to Michael Bagley, who plays AFL?
Ooh.
Good question.
Yes.
Might be.
You're an AFL fan?
Yeah, I don't mind AFL. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
And a guitar fan?
I mean, I've been playing since I was 14 years old. And it really sucks for me because I don't get to play.
I only found this out about you on Saturday.
Yeah, because
and you're here. That's cool.
I don't call myself a guitar player.
Mm.
I was going to say that. It's so funny. No, because like you say, you found out on Saturday and now I'm here. It sounds like I have nothing to do.
Which is true. Dragged you in.
You know what? I don't like to say that I'm a guitar player because I don't think I'm a very good guitar player. I'm self-taught. I just was at high school, Kalamunda High School, back in the day. In Perth, which is in the hills.
Yeah.
And a lot of the cool kids played guitar. It was an art school. Yes. So a lot of kids played guitar and instruments and had a very good music program. And I just wanted to be cool as well. And Nirvana was huge.
Yes.
Offspring were huge. Smashing Pumpkins, all that kind of era. And I was just wanting to play. Mid-90s, I reckon.
Mid-90s.
Yeah. Silverchair, as we were saying, was just literally coming through. And yeah, I really loved just jumping on a guitar and playing, and I taught myself, and my friends that were playing, they would just show me, you know, like, oh, I'll tell you my first ever thing I had was, no, I can't remember it now, oh no, but it was,
which tune?
No, hang on, it was Plateau by, which is not a Nirvana song, but it was on the Unplugged in New York album. Right.
Okay.
And they covered it. And then obviously the...
Oh, yeah. That's a great track.
Yeah, easy.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And I just loved all of that, which was fantastic. And
that's cool, man.
Yeah. And I bought myself a guitar and played and saved my pennies up to get me a Boss Distortion BD-1, which was amazing.
The Blues Driver.
Yeah.
I like that.
It was so good.
There's some great mods to that pedal, which we'll talk about. Well, why don't we play along with the song? Let's do some chair.
Let's do a little bit of chair.
And then we'll come back and talk more about guitars and what you're doing and
great
radio stuff.
Because it's funny about, after we play some Silverchair, it's a good story to go into like what they were like at the time. And,
yes.
And back then, it's crazy. And I remember, I'll tell you all about it, but let's play it first.
Well, when you suggested Tomorrow,
that's
the song we're going to do, folks, I had a look at the film clip.
Yeah.
I thought, oh my God, they were young.
Was it the Pig Man one? Because there were two film clips. Because you said your brother did like a clip.
He did. Yeah, he did a couple.
Because there
of
was...
Of course, I can't remember.
No, there was one.
Look them up.
Can't remember. And it was really old school. And it was quite an Australian looking... I don't want to say budget, but
I think it might be that one.
And then there was like a re-release when Tomorrow was a single for in America. And it was a Pig Man.
Maybe. I think I've seen the clip that I had a look at. They're very, very young.
Wearing a Nirvana shirt or an Offspring shirt?
It's something like that.
Yeah.
He's got the long...
Blonde hair.
Sort of blonde hair or whatever. They look 15 years old.
They were. So they were 14, 15.
All right.
Yeah, okay. They really were, which is crazy.
Let's do it. Let's do Tomorrow.
Yeah, great.
And then we'll have a look at it. Lean forward. Michael Ray. G'day, mate.
Hey, man. Dun, 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 dun. Now, I'll play the intro.
Oh, cool. Yeah. Go for it.
Cool.
Have you turned that up, sir?
I have.
Now, hopefully this will play through. Oh no, I have to replug it.
Uh-oh.
Live troubles.
Now this is exactly why.
What happened to Trav in Sydney.
We are live.
Oh, hang on.
No, it's... Here we go, take three.
Take three. Boom. Whoa.
fell straight down.
I always think that's where the distortion comes in.
No,
make it slow.
It's unbelievable.
When they wrote that.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
It's really amazing. And he's amazing. I think he's incredible.
I kind of think...
One of the great Australian...
Yeah.
Australian musicians.
And I feel like, for me, it's... And what I was going to say beforehand is I remember being... Growing up, and Nirvana was huge,
yes.
Right? And because you see these kids who are playing this grunge and... I mean, while... Like, it's a very... It's quite... It's not a very technical song. Tomorrow. And things like Israel's Son, they're all drop D kind of stuff, and Shade, yeah, and Pure Massacre, and all of that, or Frog Stomp.
Yeah.
Like, it was a very basic sounding album.
Mm.
And there was so
many...
Is that
all from the one album?
Yeah.
Wow, that's incredible.
And I feel like, I remember people, you weren't allowed to like Silverchair, because they were, you know, they weren't cool, and they were Kurt Cobain and Nirvana wannabes. And...
That is partly...
Yeah, I know, but like, And I feel now, knowing what I know about Daniel Johns and seeing his, and not just his, but basically, well, Silverchair, I know that he's the brains behind everything, but his progression through music, I feel like he knew as a 14-year-old, or he had some people around, I think maybe his family, his mum might have worked at Sony or something like that, and just knew the industry.
Yeah. I think you can see the talent on those songs.
Yeah, for sure.
There's a little bit more to it, you know.
And I feel like, and I'm not trying to shit can him at all here, but I feel like he kind of was smart enough to go, you know what, I can't go out there and write, like, you know, a diorama-style album.
Yeah.
Number one, he probably couldn't because, of you know, he wasn't developed yet. But he also needed to write something that was catchy, something that was easy, something that was quite digestible.
Yes.
And then once he had made a name for himself, that's when he could start to go down that experimental type of road.
Yeah. Well, he sort of went from that to, you know, loving Brian Wilson and going into that diorama album.
Yeah.
I think that's where my brother did a clip. I'd have to look that up.
I'm sorry you dropped that. Would you like me to pick that up? But you might, you know.
Sorry, brother.
He was like a bird without a cage, just out.
Yeah.
And like going, you know what? That's fine.
He's still doing great stuff too.
Yeah.
I didn't really see, did you see the Denton interview?
No, but I think somebody, was it you that told me about it? Somebody told me about that just yesterday maybe, right. Well, wasn't you?
Yeah.
And saying it was amazing.
Yeah, no, it wasn't me.
It wasn't, no, yeah. It was.
I've seen clips from it.
Yeah, it was meant to be amazing. But, and I feel like, I mean, Freak Show, that was a really great album as well.
Yeah.
And then when they went away for a bit, you know, and he had his health issues and things like that. And when he came back with Straight Lines.
Yeah, I love Straight Lines.
Do you remember that?
Yeah.
I remember it was the first performance, and I think it was at the Arias. Mm. And it was just like, boom.
Mm.
What a song.
Like, yeah.
Such
I'm
a
glad
great
you
song,
like that, because I remember when that came out and I was telling everybody, that is a fantastic song.
Yeah.
A lot of people I knew said, oh, I can't stand it. It's not like their old stuff. I'm like, what are you talking about? That's a killer pop single.
Yeah, 100%. It had everything. It was very technical, but also like just a great, powerful song.
Yeah, it just got all the bits in the right spots.
He did, didn't
and,
he?
Very catchy. How'd you get from Sydney to Melbourne?
Well, after I stuffed up.
Yes.
You got on that plane.
Yeah.
No, I was in Sydney for 4 years. So.
Did you like Sydney?
No.
Okay.
I love the city.
Yeah.
I love the opportunity. It was like moving from Perth, and Perth is like a lot of country towns. It's a beautiful city. It'll always be home, but I could never live there again.
Yeah.
Sorry, Mum, if you're watching.
I'm from Brisbane.
It's exactly the same as Brisbane. And you get people that live one street away from their house, and they do their job, and they go, you know, to brunch on a Saturday morning and upload a post to Instagram, and they're happy to do that, and that's cool, like, you know, that's fine. You get people that love to be that big fish in a small pond. But for me, as soon as I got to like a level, I remember Hamish and Andy first came in to the show, and because I was the strongest panel up button pusher, they assigned me to, you know, look after
them. That's cool.
And that was such great guys. Like, I mean, like, I'm still great friends with the whole team. Real tight-knit community, real group of friendship, like, you know. And I just felt like I loved watching their creativity and everything that they had. And because, obviously, I was quite interested in that kind of thing, and they could see.
Were you there from the beginning of their show?
When I first was in Perth, they were doing a show called the Almost Tuesday Show, and then they did Saturday mornings. And then just as I moved from Perth, like 6 months before, they started the Drive show.
Right.
So yeah, so I did, and then I got that opportunity, and because like I did a good job, I didn't stuff up, it's great. They would always use me whenever they were not in Melbourne, because they're Melbourne based, obviously. So whenever I was in Sydney, you know, and having guys like that who are amazing, they always vouch for you, and they, you know, have a lot of time for you, and they appreciate someone who can do their job right. And you know, they're pretty harsh on people that don't. They're fun, but like they don't really want to, you know, they wouldn't, if someone's not great, they wouldn't like berate them, and they wouldn't, you know, make them feel bad. They would just not probably use them again.
I guess when you get to that level,
yeah,
you've got to be a little bit cutthroat about who you're working with. And
Yeah, well, I mean, it's crazy because it's just like writing a song, I suppose. You can have the greatest song in the world, but if you can't get it in the studio and perform it, what's the point?
Yeah,
you
know? Exactly.
And so anyway, long story short, I didn't really like the people there. It was a very, Sydney's a very cutthroat industry, and I feel people are very insecure with their jobs. And, you know, rather than helping other people, they would go, oh, why are you in the studio for? Mm. I'm like, oh, I'm just recording a demo. What's the demo for? Why haven't I been asked to do a show? Like, you know what I mean?
I can always tell when people from... Sorry, Sydney, but I'm going to say...
Oh, this. Plenty of people are lovely. I've still got some great friends. But just in this industry, I'm going to say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Opera House is very pretty. And the bay is nice. Yeah.
No, it isn't. So,
I can always tell. There's just something about... good or bad.
Mm.
Something about people from Sydney. And I think... At the moment, there's more people there.
Yep.
I think it's probably a little bit more cutthroat
yep.
in whatever you're doing. Property is expensive. So when they come in the shop here, it's kind of like, you know, they'll kick an amp over and, is this it? God damn it, you know. And
that seems aggressive. Wow.
They're a little bit full on. And I always say, up from Sydney, sir.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. Enjoying Melbourne, are you?
Mm. Oh, the bloody weather.
Yeah. How do you live here?
Yep.
Rotten kernel.
Quite.
Thank you, sir. Have a good day. You know. So
go get yourself a nice coffee, mate.
That's right.
Idiot. No,
yeah.
Yeah, I agree. And for me, it was like, and when I came to Melbourne, I found that, like, I had some good friends in Sydney, but I just felt like that they weren't, I don't know whether it was because they were clicky or because, and it's something that other people have discussed. I don't know whether it's clicky or if it's because, you know, whatever the reason might be, but you'd go, oh, what are you up to this weekend? Oh, you know, I'm going to go to my mate's place for a barbecue. Oh, cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
Guy that doesn't live in the city, doesn't have, you know, not from Sydney, don't have many friends.
Yeah.
And when I came to Melbourne, it was very much the opposite. It was like, I sat at a barbecue once, the second day I got here, and I sat along with about 20 people. And I realized that the person whose house it was that I knew wasn't actually in this group of 20 people, but I'd just been talking to these people for so long, and it was great. And I'm like, oh, where's Rowan at? And he was like, oh, he's in the kitchen. He's been cooking the thing. I'm like, oh, cool. But I still speak to these people and, you know, go to the footy and stuff with them. And that, you just wouldn't have that in Sydney.
Yeah.
Like, it's just not as inclusive. But the radio station, it was in a bad time. Today FM, the management was a bit,
Is it still there? Is it gone?
The radio station?
Yeah,
it is, but it's unfortunately very, like, the ratings aren't. They're building it back up, and they've changed formats, and they've changed music, and the whole team is different, but it was a bit, it was a little bit, I don't know, like, it wasn't a fun place to be.
Yeah.
And I worked on the Hot 30 Countdown, which was fantastic. I loved that. And, you know, got some great opportunities, had some really fun times.
That's amazing.
Made some fun content, interviewed some really cool people. And yeah, like, just, I got to the point where it was 4 years in and I'm like, oh, Hamish and Andy said, hey, do you want to come down? And, you know.
Oh, so you moved down for that?
Well, I moved down with, not like with a job, but they said, hey, we might be looking soon. You know, you should come down. And the team here is very much like a family at Fox FM, and it's a really good culture. And yeah, and I moved down pretty quickly. Okay, so,
and what were you doing when you came down that gave you a show on Fox FM to do in the afternoons, or were you doing the mornings, or?
I actually said to my boss that I had been doing day shifts on Today FM, and I hadn't been. I'd been doing night stuff, which is the stuff where they put people in the background. But I'd been doing a lot of Hot 30 stuff, like, you know, as a, which is a national show.
Yes.
And I got to do a lot of, you know, interviews and out on the streets and fun stuff like that, but I'd never hosted the show.
Jumping in cars with Justin Bieber.
Yes, that was fun.
We'll talk about that.
We will. Yeah, and I suppose for me, it was so funny because, like, I'm the kind of person that if I believe that I can do a job, I will say that I could do the job or do anything to get that job because I know that I can do it. However, if I don't think I can do it and there's somebody better for the job, then I'm not going to say that I can do it, you know. And I just talked shit and said, yeah, I've been doing it for ages. And he's like, oh, cool. Can you, you know, give me a demo? Can you send some of your stuff through? And I'm like, oh, I haven't been doing any day stuff. How about I pretend I'm on Fox FM? So I'll just, you know, do some local breakfast show stuff, and I'll do some blah blah blah, and like, you know, some, hey, what about the MCG stuff, you know? And he goes, oh, that's a great idea. And so I just went into a studio and gave him five breaks that I did as a demo, and he was like, oh yeah man, I can tell you've been doing this for ages, you're great. And I was just like, you know what I mean, like, yeah. If you can do the job, I think there's a stigma on a lot of people, like, you know, it's that old school, like, oh, you've got to work your way up, and, you know, we're not going to give you a chance, you know, but if you, why? But if you do a good job, you know, like, you know.
I'm not saying lie all the time.
Yeah, so they gave just, me, yeah, just if you just, think you can do
yeah,
it.
Yeah, if, you, if it gets you ahead in life.
Which it always does. But no.
So all the time.
Yeah, no, but, and at the end of that, like, he just said, look, we've got some 6 p.m. till 7 p.m. Shifts coming up, because it was...
That's a good shift.
Yeah, because it was over the summer break and people were off. Yeah. And I just remember sitting in there the first time and just like, oh, shit, I'm about to go live on Melbourne radio at peak time.
Yeah.
Like...
That is peak time.
Yeah, it's literally right in the slot. Yeah. And it was the most terrifying but amazing thing. And yeah, just never look back.
That's cool. How are your ratings? It's all about ratings.
Yeah, you don't. Like, to be honest with you, it's the breakdowns. You can't. Like, I'd always go, oh, yeah, I'm off the back of Hamish and Andy, who are rating a 12, which is really good. And I'm like, yeah, of course, they're sticking around for me. But you can't segment it that much. Like, so you couldn't tell 6 to 7. So I just say that mine were great.
I have a friend of mine that works at the ABC at the moment.
Oh, yeah.
And the morning team that took over from Red.
Okay.
They're not rating that well. And there's a little bit of concern, but...
You know what sucks, though? Mm. And, like, this is what... Like, I love radio, but it's broken as much as TV is. And we've spoken about this off-air, that, like, it's literally in a shift, you know, in a digital shift.
Yes. It's an interesting time.
It is an interesting time. And I remember back in the day, like, you know... Well, ratings, it's the same as anything. Like cabs, they've got a monopoly or something, and they say what goes. They've got the government backing, they say what goes, you know, and there's nothing to really regulate or compete against. Radio, their ratings are essentially a couple of hundred people in the suburbs who get delivered a book, and they just tick what they think they listen to. Like, what do you listen to?
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and it's a very, like, it's a book. Like, what do you listen to at 4 p.m. on a Tuesday afternoon? And you go, oh, I think I listen to Fox FM. That's why it's so important whenever you come off a song to brand the station. You know, 101.9 The Fox or Hamish and Andy, the home, you know, that 101.9 The Fox, home of Hamish and Andy, home of this. Because that's the stuff that sticks in people's minds. So when they tick those books, they go, oh, I think I listen, I remember hearing that. So I'll tick Fox FM. I've
got to write this stuff down.
Yeah.
You're with Shootin the Strings and Trav Roebuck. Hey,
it does. It sounds nice. You've got a nice voice.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. That's like a radio. That's my Radio Australia voice.
Is it?
Yeah.
I hate
Classic FM.
I hate people that do radio voices, and I'm not saying that there, but it's so funny. You'll see people, and you've got to be excited.
Yeah.
But I think that, like, it's too hard to do a voice. You know?
Yeah. I think you've got to be yourself.
I've stood in a radio studio with a friend of mine, and, like, I've just been talking normally, like, back and forth like this. Yeah. And then all of a sudden you hear there's a 101.9 The Fox, it's Trav Roebuck here. Like, and I've been like going like, where did that come from? Like, just talk.
I got to say, I mean, I think people are so, if they weren't over that like 10 years ago, you know, they're so over that fake radio, television personality sort of thing. People just want you to be yourself.
And why do people always talk like this on the news? It's like, just read it.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
It's so much harder to do that and nobody cares.
Yeah. It's a bizarre industry, which is changing a lot.
Yeah.
And you have gone from running Hamish and Andy.
Well, let's not say that. Let's definitely not say that.
We'll cut out running.
Yeah.
And working with Hamish and Andy.
Yeah.
And you've left and you're going to do your own thing. You're doing your own thing.
Yeah. Well, so we just, a couple of friends of mine, and it's really great. As we're talking, you know, things are moving from radio to, you know, and TV and those more linear style, you know, means of broadcast and content. And I hate the word content as well. Like, people like, oh, you've got to make good content. It's like, shut up. Just do something cool. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, stop being wanky. Yeah. Those people that go, the kind of content I like to create, I'm a content creator. Shut up, mate. Just, you know what I mean?
Shut your mouth.
Shut your mouth, fool. Shut your mouth when you're talking to me. Yeah, and it's just... Like, I don't know, like, it's, as we say, like, radio, TV, and that, if you look at the stats, and I don't want to get too bogged down in the stats, but it's crazy, because, as I say, with radio, people just tick books, and then that's like, that, they go, okay, we've got a sample size group of 200 people, let's magnify that by, you know, X amount of people in Melbourne, and that's how we calculate the ratings. And it's like, well... That's weird. Like, no, that's not how...
It's a very small sample size.
Yeah, and you can't do that. And with digital, it's so much more apparent. It's so much more in your... Like, you go onto YouTube and you see, you know, people watching. You go onto Facebook and you see people watching.
Well, it's much it's much more trackable. So.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. And not only that, it's people don't want that, you know, unengaging kind of... content at them, or like a show or something at them, played at them. They like to search the, you know, they don't want to wait a week for, you know, the new Game of Thrones to come out. They want to watch them all in one go. They want to watch them when they want to watch them. They don't want to sit there at 9 o'clock on a Monday night, you know.
Absolutely.
And the same as radio, like, you know, you don't want to sit there. That's why podcasting is huge at the moment. And it's just such a hard thing for people to, you know, so to fathom in that industry. It's the way that it's been doing it for so long. But
what do you think's going to happen in 10 years time, 5 years time?
Well, we've got some really weird, like, with the business we do online broadcasting, and it's great because it's like a radio station or a TV station, and we basically do what you see on, you know, on TV or what you hear on radio, but in an online space for an online audience. And I think that that's the hardest thing for big companies to realize. They think, oh, we need to be on Facebook. There's like a 65-year-old man who just hears the word Facebook and doesn't understand it and goes, put us on Facebook. Are we on Facebook? Colonel, are we on Facebook? Yes, we are. Box ticked.
That's my demo, my demographic,
yeah. Yeah, great.
Hello, 65-year-old man. How are
you? I love a good 65-year-old man. Oh, that sounded really weird. Wow.
A silver fox.
Yes.
I think they call them.
Well, silver 1019 the fox. yeah, and so essentially, you know, they don't understand that you need to do a business. You don't need, you can't just put what you hear on radio or a TV show straight onto online. It doesn't work.
That's correct.
That's not what the new generation of people and new demographics, the younger demographics want. And that's why it doesn't work. And they just go, oh, this Facebook stuff's crap. Look at this. We've got no views. That's exactly what they all sound like. And so it's yeah, but like for me, knowing the industry and knowing if I have Ed Sheeran on Hamish and Andy and it's a pre-recorded like interview, and we play that, mate, we might have done that on a Monday and we play it back on a Thursday at 4 p.m. and then closing the phone lines off because people want to speak to Ed. They want that interaction with Ed. They want to like, oh my God, I spoke to Ed Sheeran. But radio is the only way you can do that beforehand, but now online, because you've got Facebook Live and things like this, you can actually interact with people and, you know, you can see, oh my God, look, there's some people and they want to ask Ed a question, they can, you know, and there is so much more choice. Like in music, you know, you just need a computer and some software to write music tracks and to compose and record your own music, the same as you can do, you can broadcast. Like, so it's changing and they need to change that format because it's not going to last. And the only people that watch radio, watch TV and listen to radio are all in that older demographic.
Yes.
And without being, I suppose, without being grim, they're going to die.
Yeah.
You know, you
you're all off to maximum security Twilight Villages. Yeah,
that's okay, because but the 65-year-olds now won't be your demographic in 5 years. So you'll have new 65-year-olds, so it won't matter.
Well, I'll tell you what's interesting. Actually, I should like some comments. Let's do that. If you have a question for Trav,
don't
send it through. Michael Skelly says, Wawa King. Oh, thank you, Michael. Good afternoon, Michael Webb. Good afternoon, Michael Ray. you're destroying the nation, blah, 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 productivity by hosting these in the middle of the day. Yes.
Oh, good. Wow. I thought that was like a little troll. And I'm like, suck it. Yeah.
I will kill you, Colonel. I'm stalking you. Yeah. Oh, Michael's on a lot. Michael is on a lot. So
thanks for coming back, Michael. I hope we're not boring you. Yeah. And so all the Michaels.
You
are
doing something on Twitch.
Yeah, so we
with
find...
With the NBA.
Yeah. So I love sport. I love music. I love movies. I love everything that was that's on, you know, obviously radio or TV. And so we looked at those stats and then like, you know what? It's so crazy that 18 to 25 year olds in the US don't actually watch conventional sports. They prefer to watch esports or something like that. And the alarming thing about that is in 20 years' time, those people, once again, they're going to be, you know, 38 to 45 year olds, and they're going to have kids and they're going to grow up with that, you know, and big corporations and sport, like, you know, the NBA, the NFL, all of this, they're not going to survive because people won't watch. So they need to adapt pretty quickly and go, okay, well, you know, how do we get to these younger demographics? And that's the scariest thing.
What, sorry to interrupt, but you know what's interesting about, so, the guitar kernel is all over social media.
I can tell.
Like a
rash.
A venereal disease. Yeah. No, like a rash. And so on Facebook, the demographic is sort of 45 to 55, mainly guys. Phew, thank God. And okay. And then Instagram is quite young.
Yeah, of course.
And YouTube is kind of in the middle.
It is.
So you've
for different things.
Yeah. So Facebook, older. YouTube, 30s. Yeah. And Instagram, younger.
Yeah.
It's quite interesting to see. So I don't know if you're cross-broadcasting.
Yeah, sometimes we do. But we just, to be honest with Facebook, for us, it's not necessarily our first choice. Mm. And that's because they have algorithms, and I don't want to get boring, but like basically
we can nerd out if you want.
Okay, well they focus on different things. So Facebook Live is going to be huge. Okay, cool. So anyone that's Facebook Live, we'll put an algorithm in where that's going to be, whoever's doing Facebook Live, we'll make sure that's in everyone's newsfeed because we want to promote that and we want more Facebook Live. Right, but then the new feature comes along and they're like, you know what, screw Facebook Live. We want to do, you know, whatever the next thing might be, like, you know, photo sharing or something like that, which is weird that they go back. But depending on what they're focusing on, the time is what the algorithm will show into most people's newsfeed first. And so a lot of the times it gets lost. So that's the tough thing. But for something like Twitch, it's there. There's no algorithm. It's like Twitter. And, you know, it's just a simple newsfeed. That's all it is. Whatever you post is there. So if you broadcast live on Twitch, which is a predominantly gaming side.
Yes,
that's but it's more, I think of it like the YouTube of, it's the live streaming of YouTube.
Okay.
So, you know, you can literally live stream anything you want.
Does it store the stream?
You can do it, yeah.
Okay.
And so you get the raw footage after that as well, and you can do what you want with it. But it's crazy, like, I'm such a stat man. I'm a stat man. Remember that song? Yeah, right. Scatman John.
Scatman.
Yeah.
You don't want to be a scat man.
No. Especially if you're German.
it's a messy game.
Don't look it up. Yeah, no, but like for me...
Hate the game, not the player.
Well, that's the one. I nearly went somewhere else, but I'm not going to. But yeah, so where will we be going with that? Like with Twitch and broadcasting, you can store that data, those files. But you can basically do whatever you want. You can stream whatever you want, and it's predominantly gaming, but they're trying to change it because it's such a crazy industry where, you know, like it's such a powerful platform, you know, and it's being underutilized just by focusing on gaming.
Yes.
But that was such a great thing for it to be, and it'll always exist. But now there are people who are coming through and going, well, hang on a second, there's a lot of audience there. How can we utilize this for something else? And that's basically what we've done. So we went to the NBA and we said, look, to be honest with you, it's going to be like, people are going to die. You're not going to get these, your league's not going to exist.
Yeah.
So we, you know, let us help you reach those people. And once again, you can't just put the ESPN style game on like a Twitch because people try that, but they don't want to watch it on TV. So why would they watch it on Twitch?
So where are you getting your feed?
So we get it from the NBA. They give us the feed, but they give us everything but no commentary.
Okay.
And so we just...
Live feed.
Yep. And so we just stream that game, much like a Facebook Live here. We have ourselves green screened at the bottom and we watch the game. And I love basketball. And I know technical stuff, but I don't want to sit there and be like, you know, number 21's got the ball, passes to the corner, 3-point shot, they're up by two. Like,
do you have to put on American accent?
That's, yeah, you do. If you're an ESPN. Because
that's a good one.
Oh, thanks, man. I've been practicing.
That's like Connecticut.
Okay. Yeah. Is it? Okay.
Yeah, it's a bit more. It's a bit northern.
Okay. So just outside of New York City, which is where...
I think so. Yeah, north of New York.
Gotcha. Yeah.
But Southern's just, yeah.
No, too... I can't. No, I'm not going to get into it. It's a lot slower.
It's, yes.
But, like, the audience online, they want real people. They want to connect with real people. They want to be able to talk to you and talk to you normally. They don't want that highly polished kind of, you know, a thing. And sometimes if you don't know much about basketball, like, Dallas here going with a 3-2 zone, like, what the hell is that? Like, if you don't know. So we watched.
Have you got exclusive rights to that? For
not us personally, but they only give it to a certain amount of people, and we were one of the ones that got it, which is fantastic. Yeah.
And so you're commentating over an NBA feed, so live games.
Yep.
Worldwide.
Yep.
Okay.
And it's the funniest thing, like. For us, I liken it to Gogglebox. So that show where people just watch TV. And the reason those shows are so popular is because people watch them as they watch them. Like, the people that are on the show are watching the show as people at home would watch the show, if that makes sense. So you feel like you're watching it with somebody the way that you would. And, you know, you're watching the game with your mates and, you know, there's no technical stuff. And you know, if you want to ask questions, and we do go through some technical stuff in the sense like, oh, yeah, that this team's good at shooting 3 points. So a 3-2 zone means that they've got three people guarding the three-point line to block them from scoring that many shots, but then they put two people back under the basket. And then, you know, people love that because they learn about it, but we just get sidetracked and it's hilarious. We talk about what the best NBA movie is. Obviously, White Men Can't Jump.
That's a cool one.
Yeah, and we talk about things like in Time Out, there's a dickhead. Am I allowed to say dickhead?
Yes.
Right.
You can say whatever you want.
What a dickhead.
I always change. I change my swear words, though.
Oh.
Like
what would you say for the C-bomb?
Oh, I'll say dunt. I'll just put a D in.
Great.
You know, duck you.
Yeah, duck off.
What a dunt.
Yeah. But now we know.
And see, it's...
Yeah.
You don't feel... No one feels bad about that.
No, duck off, mate. Whatever. And for us, like, there was this guy, for instance, wasn't this idiot, courtside, and he was watching through binoculars.
Oh, wow.
And we're like, what are you doing, you crazy man? Like, you are courtside. You literally can reach the guys and touch them. Why are you... Why?
Was it Jack Nicholson?
It wasn't, actually. But we had this conversation, and people are going, oh, he's definitely looking at chicks, you know. And then, you know, we'd be watching the game, and we're like, okay, cool, yep, great, blah, blah, blah. And then someone would go, oh, he's doing it again. And we're like, ah, oh, look at this guy. Like, but if, you know what I mean? It's a more inclusive kind of...
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's...
So did you start doing that while you were working up the road here, or did you just say, you know what, it's a great idea, I'm going to go with it?
We actually designed a TV show.
Right.
Yeah, we designed a TV show around esports. And I'm not really huge on esports. Like, it's a bit too geeky for me. And I feel like, me in general, like, I'm not very cool at all in the sense that, like, you know, I like pop music. I like, you know, crazy. I would never know. You said you had Jack from the Preachers in here. And, like, I couldn't tell you a Preachers song. I'm sorry. But I know that it must be good, but I just don't. That's just not me.
A young person had to tell me who they were.
Okay, cool.
A couple of years ago.
Yeah, but you know what I mean, though.
Yeah.
And so esports is similar in that sense, where like I don't know League of Legends, I don't know all these games, I don't know how to play them, I don't have any interest in them, but I know that there's a lot of people out there like me who like to play NBA 2K, who like to play FIFA, who like to play Call of Duty. They don't sit in their parents' bedrooms, basements for 20 hours a day watching or playing.
You obviously know basketball, though.
Yeah, but I feel that that's a bit more mainstream. So we wanted to kind of find a balance between gaming, esports, and mainstream.
Right.
So people wouldn't just go like, what is this crazy esports, and segregate people. It's more inclusive.
Why Twitch?
Well, we designed the TV show. We actually pitched to Fox Sports News. And like, it's crazy. Like, if you, for somebody to walk in a suit, and like pitch in front of like the big wigs of you know, Fox Sports, the big network, was such a surreal experience.
And were they woofing down lines of cocaine and?
Yes. No, they weren't. They weren't.
They definitely were. Yeah. I mean,
no, weren't.
That's just
And for me, like, I mean, I'm an idiot. I don't know anything. Like, you know, I'm a very fake it till you make it kind of guy. I'm the guy that said to the boss, hey, yeah, I've been doing days at Today FM in Sydney. Yeah, I can do that. And I think you just got to back yourself sometimes. And if it doesn't work out, you've got to just, you learn about it and it's an experience.
Exactly.
And I shit bricks, like, you know, every single time. Like, even yesterday, just to digress quickly, I was talking to a venture capitalist company about investing in the business. And I've never done that in my life. I didn't even know what a venture capitalist was this time last year. And it's crazy to think, like, I'm sitting in a meeting. Or the NBA. Like, here's this idiot in his apartment in South Bank with, like, PJs on at 12 o'clock at night with a suit and tie, like, top.
Yep.
And talking to, like, a boardroom of executives from the NBA.
Wow.
Do you know what I mean? Like, it's just, it's crazy. But
how did you, when you were pitching your idea to them?
To the NBA?
Yeah. Were they asking you, was it more about what is it? Give us, or were they asking you specific questions about the game, or?
Oh no! So we actually spoke to Twitch itself.
Right.
So like at first we didn't have any contact with the NBA. We told them what we wanted to do, and we told them what our plans were, and they were like, "Well, actually, we've been trying to get sports involved. We actually are talking with a partnership with the NBA, so we can connect you." And so that was with Twitch. So that, like, we just made that contact through Twitch, which is great. But we were kind of just, showing them that, you know, there's a better way to do it. Not in an arrogant way. That sounds arrogant. Like, you know, but I just feel, do you know what I mean? Like, I feel like that people need a choice.
Yeah.
And people, you know, there are people that will love an ESPN broadcast, but then there's a lot of people that wouldn't.
Well, there's a lot of people, a lot of people on the board of directors of different companies who probably have no idea about this sort of stuff. They want
exactly.
to know,
And for us, like, going back to the TV show, we pitched it, and they were really interested in the show, which was great. And we'd done our due diligence, and we'd gotten people on board and partners on board, and everyone was really excited about the show. And then they were like, oh, you know what? We don't have any spots until Q3, which is the third quarter of the year. And this was in Q1, so like at the start of the year. And they said, you know what? Like, we'd love to talk in the future. And I did my research and I looked at the numbers and I was just like, TV's dying.
Yeah.
Like, this is crazy.
I'm amazed it's still going.
Yeah.
Commercial TV.
In Australia. Live sports, the only thing that's keeping it afloat. That's the only thing.
Has to be. State of origin sort of stuff.
Yeah, exactly. And once those broadcast rights get, you know, segregated into other platforms, not Optus, but you know what I mean? Like, it's one of these things where...
You can try again, Optus. Yeah. Come on board with us here.
No, mate, well... You won't stream. It will stop up.
Actually,
and then only if SBS come in to rescue. And so, but like, so with Twitch in the TV show, we actually heard about Twitch and had no idea what the hell this thing was. And I looked at it and I'm like, why are people watching this? This is stupid.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
There are so many people watching this.
Yeah.
And I'm like, imagine if we actually put something good on.
Yeah.
That was my arrogant mindset.
Yeah. Like the guy who wears the... I can't remember his name. There's a famous guy on Twitch.
Yeah.
In a mullet.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Dr. Disrespect. Yeah.
That's the guy.
Yeah.
He's amazingly popular, though.
But it's weird. Like,
yeah, it's pretty weird.
He doesn't do anything, you know? And so with the TV show, we thought, okay, we want to try to cross-promote this idea somehow, so let's put it on Twitch. We can do live exclusive content behind the scenes, you know, all that kind of stuff on Twitch. And then I looked at the numbers on Twitch, and I'm like... There are millions of people watching this as opposed to maybe a couple of hundred thousand at best. And some of our NBA broadcasts had
over
a million views, like 1.5 million views.
Oh my God, wow, that's
and
amazing.
Like the project here last Sunday night, because I'm across this stuff, had 400,000 people watching it.
Yeah.
So to think that like these idiots in a South Bank apartment with a green screen, yeah, watching a game of NBA has three times the amount of viewers than a major corporation like Channel 10, yes, and that kind of a show. Yeah. And that's what, that's the hardest thing to, I suppose, to educate people on.
Yeah.
Is to go, like, because you just think, oh, what do? I've got, you know, a star, I've got Ed Sheeran coming in to perform. Like, what do? I'll put him on the project. Mm. That's the biggest thing, of course. I'll put him on, you know, yeah, SEA Night. I'll put him on Nova Nights. And that's great. There's always a place for that. But there are other options out there that you can reach a huge, like a much larger audience.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I was just talking to somebody about this yesterday or the day before, that with the Jack Moffat interview that I did last week.
Yeah.
In a week. Okay, it hasn't had a million views.
No, but still.
But it's had 4,500 that's views amazing. in a week on Facebook.
Great.
I mean, how many people can you fit in the forum? I don't know, 1,500 people or something. So it's basically like selling out a couple of nights at a big venue.
Exactly.
Just to come in here with me.
Hey, guys.
And now Trav, who's my executive
producer. I told you this is not part of the plan. So what we're going to do is we're going to quickly hook the next segment, tease something else, and then we'll push back to ads, and we'll be back in 3 minutes' time. Okay, go. Got it?
That's too tech. That's too high tech for me.
We might take a caller as well. 13, 10, 16.
I think he
understood it. But ooh, yeah.
Let's see who else we have on.
Sorry, guys. I've been talking shit for so long.
Oh, Cam Stevens. Pete Mitchell. Pete's doing the country with Chocolate Starfish at the
moment.
Are
you serious?
I am.
That's
They're
amazing.
Doing NXS covers.
Wow.
Yeah. Selling out venues everywhere. So good on you, buddy. Rob Quantrell is on. Ben McGeorge is on. Frank Leong from Sydney.
Oh,
hi guys.
Frank Leong. That's I like it. Frank Leong.
Yeah.
Yeah, great. Thanks for watching, guys.
Yeah, cool. So, NBA.
NBA, yeah.
Twitch.
Yep.
How do we find your channel?
Okay, so it's the word celebrity, but instead of a Y on the end of celebrity, it's an E.
Okay.
So, celebrity with an E, league. So, celebrity league.
Celebrity League.
So you get it? See, E-League, Electronic League, same as Electronic Sports.
Yep.
Celebrities on our league on eSports, Celebrity League.
That's cool. That's cool. I will post all the info later
thanks,
in
man.
The description.
That'd be sick.
So at the moment, it's just NBA commentary. You're doing it with a buddy?
Yeah, we are, but we're actually working with a lot of movie companies. We're working with a lot of other sports. F1 is one that we're looking at.
There's more to come.
Yeah. We're looking at the NFL as well, Major League Soccer in the States. But we're talking to movie companies, to music companies, all the record labels, and things like that, and gaming as well. Like, we just want to do some fun shit.
Yeah, amazing. Know? And like, to leave a job, like Hamish and Andy, producer, to go and do it, that's a big call.
No, the boys were leaving anyway, and I'm not really passionate about any other show.
Yeah.
So I don't want to do something I'm not passionate about. And it's crazy because we get to do, there's a lot of branded content and a lot of money being thrown out, and brands have $200,000-$300,000 just to, you know, they need to spend this money on campaigns.
Is that how you're making money from this at the moment? That brands, you're getting a million views and then brands come and you advertise
sponsor that sort of thing. Yeah, but we don't like to just like shove it down. Like, I don't want to do brands that aren't going to fit, you know, and with a brand, for instance.
You don't want to do the steak knife stuff.
No. I mean, give us some money if you want stuff. Like, get my boy Tim in. What's his name? Tim freaking...
He's the king.
Tim Shaw?
It's Tim Shaw.
Tim Shaw from Demtel. But wait, there's more.
It'd be cool if you got some of those like high-tech Japanese knives, though, that Tetsuya does or something.
I wouldn't have said Japanese, mate.
Oh, yeah. No good.
Well, but I just feel like, you know, I wouldn't single out a race.
Oh, okay. Yeah. They make good knives.
They do, don't they?
That's why I said
that's
it.
A very generalistic comment. You've said stop generalizing, mate.
Japanese and German knives.
I'm German.
Are you?
Yeah, meine Schwester ist aus einer dicke Kuh. Yeah, du bist das, mein kleiner Junge.
Auf Wiedersehen. No, that's good.
Means I have to leave.
That's all I know.
I mean, like, we love to do, like, say, for instance, Call of Duty is coming out, and it's obviously the war game. And we want to recreate that in real life. With full helicopters, you know, like full outfits, paintball guns, and live stream that.
Right.
But we're talking at the moment about potentially building a stage from Call of Duty to a real life paintball field. So a stage that you'd see in an upcoming game in real life, and that's what we would run around playing paintball with.
That's huge.
And so it's for us, it's just, yeah, it's just fun, you know. And it's very, I don't know, like, it's just, there's a lot of content out there that's just, you know, like interviews and things, like, so who would you like to collaborate with? You know, like, oh, what was your favorite part of making this album? It's like, nobody cares.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
Well, there's a lot of short snippet stuff, you know, in the traditional format. I think the long form interview, the Joe Rogan type.
Yeah, that's great.
Is much.
Oh, yeah.
Much better.
But the thing is, though, what they do is like
changing the game.
Yeah, but the thing is, there's a lot of people out there, like, you know, they just want to get as many eyes and ears across as they can. So, you know, someone like an Ariana Grande, who your audience wouldn't know, will come out and have a tour, and she'll be in Australia, and she'll be doing one day of press, and she will literally visit 48 radio stations.
Yeah.
And it's like, and then the project that night. So you hear her on the project, you see her on the project, you see, hear her interviews on Fox FM, on Nova, on Kiss, on Gold, on all these radio stations, and they're the same interview. It's like, hey, quick, all right, we're going to do something wacky here.
Yeah.
Ariana, like, we're going to play a game of what's costs more. Is it Ariana Grande, or is it Ariana not so Grande? You know what I mean? Like, just
that's one thing that drives me crazy. And it's normally, like, I mainly listen to AM radio these days, but just with the commercial FM stations, if it's a morning team or an afternoon, the drive team, everyone seems to, has to be happy and up and all the time, you know, and it's like, I think a lot of the time it comes across fake.
It does, yeah, you know? It definitely does, yeah.
And it's very hard for people to hold that audience and be natural.
Of course.
And
I guess it takes too much effort, though. It's like, it's so exhausting.
Yeah.
Like,
I'd rather be just dark and morose, like I am every time I'm on.
We are certainly dark, and I was going to say ominous, but you know.
that is true.
Yeah.
I'll tick that. I'll go with that. Well, Travis.
Yeah.
We've
spoken longer. So long.
It's gone long, and I know you're busy. Man. And I just want to say thank you so much for coming in.
My pleasure.
A quick one for you.
Yeah, go.
Famous band that you're mucking about with and in.
In. Okay, so, and it's got a tie to ACDC. I think it gave you that tease. That's what we call a tease in the industry.
I need these.
When I was in high school, and the person who taught me how to play guitar was a kid who used to live two suburbs away from me, and we had quite a long bus ride, and we traveled to work, to school every day together on the same bus. Mm. And he was, you know, seemed cool, and I just got to chatting to him, and he taught me how to play guitar. His name was Drew Wooten.
And
he had a brother, Miles, and Drew played guitar, Miles played drums, and Miles was a couple of years younger. And anyway, he introduced me to a guy called Justin Laffer, who was in my science class, and we all kind of like went to play, you know, guitar and stuff in the art room and music room and things like that. Justin Laffer now goes by the name Jay Laffer, and they started a band called The Panics. Melbourne based now, Perth boys originally.
All right, that's great.
I played with them, not as The Panics, but with Jay, with Drew and Miles, I reckon probably about 3 years, and we played everything.
We played everything
from like Spiderbait to Powderfinger and Nirvana, and I think our first performance was that's it, yeah. A little Sunshine of Your Love by Craig.
I like the high one. The low one's cool.
Yeah. And such a good song.
Gets the wire out.
It does. No, 100%. And fun fact as well is the tie to AC/DC, as we look at your poster up there, of Angus. But their dad, John, was in a band with Bon Scott.
Oh, right. Wow.
And John was a drummer for that band.
Incredible.
And they... Bon was going to move to Melbourne, and Bon said, hey, John, I want you to move to Melbourne with me. I've got these two brothers that I want to start a band with. And so John asked his new wife, Miles and Drew's mother, who didn't want to leave Perth. And so he had to do the, you know, sorry, she doesn't want to leave. So stayed behind in Perth, And obviously Bon went on to form AC/DC with them. Like, so yeah, could have been the drummer for AC/DC.
Could have also drank himself to death. Yeah, in a car.
And I wouldn't have
met
his two sons, and I would not have played guitar, and probably would not have been here.
There you are.
So suck it. Who's the real loser?
Well, I'm glad you're here. A customary handshake, sir.
Thank you, sir.
We'll have to get you back in for more. Part two, I'll be contacting the Panics and using your name.
Yeah, do it.
To get them in.
Yeah.
But Amanda, what more?
What more?
What more?
What?
Sure,
what?
I want more. She says, g'day, g'day, and thanks for everyone for tuning in.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Sorry I talk shit. I don't talk shit for so long.
Oh, man. It's great. It's so good. I love people that talk. It's the best thing. I can sit back and be like, oh, good.
I don't have to drive it. No, thank you so much, mate. I appreciate it.
No, thanks for coming in. This will be on YouTube and iTunes. If you're watching us on YouTube, please subscribe.
We need
more subscribers. And go check out Trav on Twitch.
Yeah, Celebrity
League. Yes. It'll be in the description and tags and all that sort of stuff.
And if you don't subscribe to the Colonel's channel, I won't tell you what will happen to you.
It's not going to be good, though.
But it won't be good.
It'll be the same thing that happened to my Pirates of the Caribbean.
You've given away too much, and I feel like we've threatened now. It's probably like
kind of a threat. It's like when my daughter and I watch Peter Rabbit, and the caption up the top, it says, low level threat.
Oh, wow.
Low level threat. It's rabbits. Right. The rabbit's having a